they hired me to fill in while Bart was on the road with Dave.
Wow.
And so I was kind of the fill-in for Bart, and it was supposed to be for 6 months, but it turned out to be 3 years. So
wow.
From 1999 until 2002,
wow.
I was playing with the Atomic Punks. I guess Matt Sensio, who was David Lee Roth's manager at the time, mm-hmm. Saw me play at a club with the Atomic Punks out in Santa Monica. And at some point, Bart got fired. They gave me a call to audition. Luckily, I had been playing Van Halen songs for 3 years, so I was very warmed up for the audition.
Absolutely. And,
I couldn't have been any readier, you know? And so it's not like I had to learn a bunch of songs. You know, a lot of times you do an audition for a band, it's like they give you a call and they say, hey, learn these four songs and we'll see you tomorrow. So this was like I've had 3 years of warming up. So I played with the drummer and the bass player at a rehearsal studio in front of the manager.
Right.
And he told me, well, it's up to me. I'd hire you on the spot, but Dave's got to see you.
Right.
So a few days later, Dave came in and I got to play a few songs in front of him. And he just shook my hand and said, looking forward to playing some shows with you. And then that originally it was for two shows.
Right.
He said he had two gigs booked in the summer of 2002.
Uh-huh.
And I said, okay, sure. And it was kind of a lot of drama happened after that because the Atomic Punks didn't want me to do it because they were afraid. Because I told them, I said, hey, I got hired to play a couple shows with David Lee Roth. And they said, oh, man, well, we'd rather you didn't do them. I said, well, why not? They said, because one show will turn to a two and then two to three. And next thing you know, you'll have to sub out gigs with our band because it will get you. Obviously, it's hard to get a fill-in guy for the Atomic Punks.
Sure.
So they offered to give me a pay raise if I turn down the Dave.
Oh, jeez.
So I just go, well, I got to do this. I've been playing guitar for, 25 years to say no to David Lee Roth. And I was doing just allegedly these two gigs, for
right.
Dave. And I was risking losing my gig with the Atomic Punks. They basically said, if you play with Dave, we're going to find a new guitar player.
Oh, wow.
And so I was really scared, but I took the gig and those two gigs turned into 5 years.
Wow.
So it worked out. Yeah, about a couple weeks after I took the gig, I get a phone call from Matt Sensio and he said, hey, we're going to do a full summer tour with Sammy Hagar. So the two gigs turned into a summer tour real quickly, and then it turned into next year, next year, next year.
That's incredible. What were the songs you played for Dave when you auditioned?
The very first one I played was Somebody Get Me a Doctor, and Dave was just sitting on a couch. So he was just watching me and I was doing the background vocals and everything, and I do the Michael Anthony parts. So
wow.
That was kind of cool because I would do the high parts. So
yeah.
That was probably a bonus for me getting the gig was the fact that I could do the mic parts. And so I played that song because I figured it was a really cool song that I could play easily. I wasn't nervous, but I wasn't sure if I was going to be nervous. So I figured I'll play something that I can play if I'm nervous. And it was funny because I'm wondering, am I going to be nervous when Dave's sitting there? But I wasn't. I was actually, I stared him right in the face while he's sitting on the couch, and I just looked right at him and played my ass off like, okay, fucker, check me out. Because I didn't have anything to lose, because if I didn't get the gig, I got a raise.
Right. That's so, true. You're
so,
right.
Yeah, so I kind of went in there with I got nothing to lose here, so I'm just going to just go balls out and, play my ass off and like, look at him with a confident look on my face. And then so I played the one song, and then he said, sounds great. He goes, let's hear Hot for the Teacher. I started laughing. I said, let's hear Hot for the Teacher. And he said, just play it up to the solo, and then stopped after the solo. So we did Hot for Teacher. After that, I can't remember what other songs, but he had me play a few more songs. He basically said, just play the song up to the solo, and then, that's after the solo, just go to another. So I played like about five songs. So it was really cool. And then when he said, looking forward to playing some shows with you, I go, well, I think that means I got hired. I wasn't sure about
her. Right.
So
that's cool.
Do you think the fact that you stared him in the eye helped you get the gig?
I think it was like he definitely, and I know him really well now, but at the time, of course, I didn't. But I know that I definitely the confident thing was important. He's kind of like a drill sergeant. He really puts you through a lot of drills and tests your mettle.
Sure.
He doesn't let it easy to get into his inner circle. He really makes it like there's a lot of tests and a lot of times where you feel like he's getting, being mean to you or yelling at you, making you feel crappy here and there. And it's almost to see if how thick your skin is. After a while, I started feeling like, okay, Dave's just kind of like seeing if I'll crumble. So you always had to just stand there with confidence. And I never really had a bad show, but once in a while, if Dave didn't have a great show, he might get upset with the band, afterwards and kind of take it out on us. So
wow.
I just got to learn the personality, and stuff. And yeah, he's definitely, one of those guys that, definitely I would say looking him in the face with confidence while you're playing is definitely a bonus for auditioning for him.
That's cool.
So I have to ask, because you and Bart Walsh were both guitarists for the Atomic Punks, which is obviously a Van Halen tribute band, and you both played with David Lee Roth. And we have spoken with Bart Walsh, God rest his soul. I mean, great guy, really fun guy to interview. But my question is, did you ever reach out to him and call him for advice, or did you ever speak to him and compare notes
about with Dave? No, because he got fired. He wasn't the guy for me to talk to because there was problems with him in the band, and he ended up getting fired from the gig. And it was kind of weird because this is really strange. When he first got the David Lee Roth gig, I really didn't know him. I knew Ralph and Joe from the Atomic Punks.
Right.
Because I had been doing the Perfect World gigs with those guys, which is this disco and different kinds of shows. So I played many shows with him with other bands, with Joe and Ralph. But I didn't know Bart or Scott at the time. Ray Luzier I also knew from, I had been playing with funk gigs with Ray. And Ray was the first guy I knew that got the Dave gig. He got it in 99. And what's funny was, when he got the gig, I didn't even know that they were going to be playing Van Halen stuff. I figured it was going to be David Lee Roth solo stuff.
Right.
So I didn't really go, hey, Ray, give me an audition. I didn't really think about it. And then next thing you know, I hear that Bart Walsh gets hired and they're going to go on tour and play all old Van Halen songs. Wow. I was like, oh, man, I was really bummed and jealous at that point. Going
sure.
Like, if I knew they were going to be doing all Van Halen, I would have been down with this stuff. So anyways, but what's funny is, so I get a call at like 2 a.m. from Ralph, and he goes, hey, Brian, our guitar player got hired by by David Lee Roth, and he said they need a guitar player for the Punks. And he goes, no offense, I've only heard you play disco. A couple people told me I should call you. And he had never really heard me play any real rock stuff. So I played I'm the One over the phone to him.
Wow.
He's like, okay. So I basically got the gig over the telephone based on a couple of people who told Ralph to call me. You know, Ralph basically hired me sight unseen just on a couple of people's word and then over the phone. So I had like 9 days. It was on a Tuesday, I think. And then I had a week for Friday. So whatever that is, to learn their 20 song set and stripe my guitar like Eddie's and all this stuff. And I was doing this. And then at the same time, what's funny is Bart called me and said, hey, Brian, you know, I got the David Lee Roth gig. Can you take over my students? Because he had 20 guitar students.
Wow.
So I said, sure. So I got Bart's students and his Atomic Punk gig.
Wow.
So I suddenly was like booked solid, you know, and I had to teach these 20 students and then do my 3 gigs a week and learn all the Van Halen stuff.
Wow.
You know, the first show, I was definitely pretty nervous because I knew that they had been around for like 5 years or no, like more than, it was like 8 years by the, in 2002. They had been around for, I'm sorry, it's 1999. So they had been around for about 5 or 6 years at the time.
Sure.
And I knew that everybody, you know, was going to be really like critiquing me, you know. I was more nervous playing the first Punks gig than I was playing the first David Lee Roth gig.
Wow.
You know, because, yeah, like I said, I felt the scrutiny. Because by the time I played with Dave, I'd been doing the Punks for so many years, I was really comfortable with the Van Halen stuff.
Right.
So it was like the first few shows. I did pretty good. I still have a video of the very first show I played.
Wow. Yeah, were you a big Van Halen fan growing up?
Yeah, all my life, yeah. I knew a bunch of songs and little bits and pieces of Eruption and parts of this, but I didn't really, you know it to the extent I had to learn. You know, I suddenly went, okay, now I got to learn, you know, their whole catalog, and I got to learn it perfect. You know, originally I'd be, you know, everyone knew a few riffs here and there. Everyone could play Talking About Love or Running With the Devil, You Really Got Me. And I think I'd messed around with Ice Cream Man before and played I'm the One with, you know, jamming with friends and stuff. So, you know, I was into Eddie enough to where I knew his style and how to get his tone pretty close. But some of the hard riffs I kind of already knew. So I already knew I could do that stuff. Then I just had to get down and really fine tune it and you know, put a microscope in, because I knew that there's going to be these guitar players with their arms folded going, wrong, he did it wrong, he did it wrong. You know, that's how a lot of those, when you're going to see tribute band, if you're not doing it right, the guitar players, if there's guys in the audience that play guitar, they're going to go, they know how to play it right, and you're up there doing it wrong, you know, you're going to have some bad reviews.
So now when you were officially in Dave's band after passing that audition, what went on from there? What kind of paces did Dave put you through?
Well, our first gig was at this thing called the Atlanta Midtown Music Festival, and it was in May of 2002. I think I got the gig in early April, and then there was a one-off gig in May, and then the tour started. I can't remember the dates now.
Like in June.
You know, I've not even been called before April. It's funny. I can't remember exactly. Somewhere early in 2002, the first couple of months, I got the call.
Right.
And then I did the audition. And then for the first few weeks, it was just me rehearsing with Ray and James. James Lomenzo,
right.
Ray Lazier.
Right.
And it would just be the three of us in a rehearsal room for about, you know, I can't even remember now, 4 hours a day maybe.
With no five singer?
Days a week. With no, we'd just be doing the backgrounds. And Ray and James had already been with Dave for a few years, so
right.
they knew the whole set. So
right.
basically, they were there to teach me the set.
Okay.
The way that Dave does the songs.
Right.
And while he'll do a breakdown in the middle of something where he'll talk, and then at the endings, how he ends the songs, you know?
Right.
And so Ray and James could show me all that stuff, and then I'd be doing the background vocals, all three of us sang, so it sounded really good. Then Dave would come in about once a week and sit down and listen, maybe sing a couple of half songs,
right.
you know, and never really did a whole song all the way through, then talk, oh, try this, try that, you know, let me hear the ending of that song. And then a week would go by, we'd just rehearse again, and then he'd come in. And then once in a while, we'd have these really cool hangs. It'd be like, you know, the band, Dave, a couple of crew guys, and maybe Dave's manager, and we'd all sit on the floor in a circle, passing around a bottle of Jack Daniels, and Dave would be playing his fucking ghetto blaster with all these old blues tunes, and go, check this out, check that out. And he had us learning all these blues covers and stuff to do acoustically on the radio. In fact, we did a full radio tour on acoustics leading up to the Sam and Dave tour. Yeah, we did a full, like we were on the tour bus, we had our acoustic guitars, and we were making our way to Cleveland, and we did like Fresno, Los Angeles, Las Vegas, Albuquerque, and then Kansas, and then Kansas City, and then and that was like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday at, you know, 6 a.m. on morning radio shows. And then we had 2 days off, then we did the next Monday, we did like Dallas, I can't remember now, Chicago, Detroit, and so then we got to Cleveland, and I think that's where the tour started, in Cleveland, and we had a few days off, and then we did a couple of rehearsals in some arena in Cleveland, and then we started the tour with Sammy. But so that was kind of fun. So the hang with Dave was really cool. You know, like that was some of the funnest times when we were sitting on the floor and Dave's got his CD player and it's got a big old books of CDs and he's pulling out these songs and popping them in and you know, smoking cigarettes and drinking Jack Daniels and just talking. And I'm just sitting there going, like, man, I wish my friends could see this. This is the coolest hang ever. We're just all sitting on the floor with Dave. You know,
how would you describe your chemistry with Dave? What was he like to work for and to perform with?
Well, okay, I'll start off with the first show. When we played the very first show in Atlanta, this one-off, it was a festival, and it was raining. It was an outdoor festival, 30,000 people, and it was like this hot, misty rain. And I realized before the show, in fact, when we were flying, before we flew out there, I said to Ray, I go, dude, I don't even know what to wear. And he said, well, bring a few things, because Dave might go, I don't like that shirt. So I brought like 3 or 4 shirts and a couple pairs of pants. So, because I wasn't even sure, and I hadn't even, I go, am I allowed to stand next to Dave on stage? Like,
right.
I didn't really go through any stagecraft, you know,
right,
like,
right.
I had never played all the songs with him or stood on the stage. So my very first show was just like, I walked out there on stage and we played the whole set with Dave. And that was the first time I played all the songs, was actually in front of the crowd. Yeah. So it was a fun show and I had a good time. Dave yelled at me a little bit because I took my shirt off before he did. And he said, I'm going to tell you this on stage so you remember. Don't take your shirt off before me. And I'm like, oh, crap, I'm in trouble. And then,
I guess if that's the worst part of the show, you did all right.
Yeah, the songs were good. It was just, but I actually thought I was going to, and after the show, he talked to me, he said, hey, you know, just wait till we take my shirt off. Because he told me before the show, it was super hot and humid. And I knew we were all going to be sweating our butts off. I think it was rainy, but it was like 80 degrees, humid and rain. So he said, yeah, even if you get hot, you can take your shirt off. I'm like, great. So after about the third song, I was sweating my butt off. I took my shirt off and I got in trouble. That was funny. But really, I only saw the good, you know, the first month of being of like the rehearsals and the radio stuff. It was all pretty good because I heard that when he gets mad, it could be pretty ugly. And I didn't really see that side till one time we had a problem on the radio show where somebody's app didn't work. And afterwards, we were on the tour bus, and Dave came out and exploded on us, and I'm like, oh, this is that temper.
Oh, boy.
So, yeah, it's kind of like it's a little bit of a bummer to be yelled at by someone that you consider a hero.
Oh, sure.
You know, but, you know, I got to see how his temper was, and I learned that when he's in a good mood, it's the greatest hang you'll ever have in your life. You know, like sometimes we'll have meetings at the titty bars, you know, that's Dave's thing. Hey, everybody, meet at Crazy Girls at 8 o'clock or 10 o'clock or whatever. And then it's just sitting, and there's nothing cooler than being at a table with their whole band with David Lee Roth at a strip club, you know, and he's buying drinks and everyone's having a good time. And it's like band meeting, you know, it's like, cool. Yeah. So that's fun stuff.
That's great.
So you're just going like, what a cool boss, you know, meetings at the strip club. There was a lot of fun times. And so I felt it was really weird. he's definitely like a person that you just always feel that you got to be on your guard around, like careful, right. Because
sure,
he's really smart and he's well read,
right?
And he can see through bullshit. So and he doesn't want to. He's not into small talk, like, so it's kind of like there's not a lot of yapping with the guy because
right.
He doesn't really. I noticed that he doesn't really care too much about bullshit. It's like, unless you got something really, like, I found that when I was telling.